My name is Adam Abate. I'm an assistant professor in bioengineering and therapeutic sciences. And I did my undergraduate degree at Harvard University in physics. And I did my PhD at the University of Pennsylvania, also in physics. The work that I'm doing here takes my work in the past using complex fluids or emulsions and is using droplets in the emulsion essentially as the containers. So I use droplets which are about 10 microns in diameter, that's about a tenth the diameter of a human hair. And these are droplets that are composed entirely of water. And they're surrounded by an oil that has a very low solubility for any kind of biological molecule. And so what you can do is you can actually put cells, proteins, enzymes, DNA, RNA, pretty much anything that's water soluble inside of the droplet, and it will stay there because the oil prevents these things from exiting. And the concept of this approach is actually asking the question, what's the simplest system that you need in order to perform an experiment, a chemical experiment or a biological experiment? And if you think about it, really what you need is you need some kind of a container, and you need to have the ability to perform functions on that container. So you have your container, you can put things inside of it. The next step is actually processing these droplets, acting on them in order to do the different things you need to do for an experiment. And that's where the microfluidics come in. The microfluidics are basically the tiny automated robots that are processing the droplets. And actually on the screen, I have a movie showing one of the really essential components, which is the sorting component. And what this does is it allows you to create a population of a billion or so droplets, each with its own particular reagents inside of it, and then to look at each droplet and decide whether or not you want to keep that droplet. And the way that you actually do that is you actually sort the droplet. And so in this movie, you can see droplets. There's two kinds of droplets. There's dark droplets and light droplets. And the light droplets are being sorted into the lower channel, and the dark droplets are being sorted into the upper channel. What I'm really interested in using this for is for doing something called high-throughput biology. And what this is, you know, there are many kinds of problems in biology where the reactions that you need to perform are actually pretty basic. They're pretty simple and well understood, but you have to perform massive numbers of them. If you want to sequence a person's genome, you need to perform about 100 billion reactions. If you were to try to do this by hand, it would take you millions and millions of years and, you know, thousands and thousands of gallons of reagents. You could just never do it. The reason that this microfluidics-based approach is really so effective is that you miniaturize the volume, the test tube volume, down to a size that is almost inconceivably small. For example, a test tube is usually, you know, it's about a milliliter or 100 microliters of reagents, about this big, and usually that's the volume that you would use to perform run reactions. It turns out that the droplets in my system are so small that you could fit an entire warehouse full of test tubes into the volume of one test tube. So in other words, you have the same number of reactions in this big a space as it would take an entire warehouse full of test tubes in order to perform. And that's really the scales we're talking about. If you do the numbers, it's about a million-fold reduction in size and volume, and about a million-fold increase in reaction rate. One of the things you can imagine doing is actually using this to discover new drug compounds by putting different combinations of drugs in the droplets and then screening them to find which one are the most effective at, for example, killing a microbe. This microfluidics approach that I've been working on is actually something that's only really been developed in the last 5 years. It's new, and as a result, people who actually can use this are not really aware of the capabilities. Evolution has been around for a long time, but we're still learning a ton about how it really works. And, you know, you can imagine that just like anything else, a good way to learn about a subject or a process is to tinker with it. But evolution is sort of peculiar in the fact that, you know, it combines you know, individuals, massive numbers of individuals over extremely long time scales in order to result in something as complex as an organism. And so it's very hard to tinker with, but directed evolution and these new really high throughput techniques are providing tools for us to start actually manipulating biological systems through evolution. You take a starting system from the native environment, a natural, say, microbe, and you mutate it, and you create billions of mutants of that original microbe, and then you need to screen all of them and then select the best ones. And if you repeat this process many times, mutating the system, you can actually evolve the system in a way that you would like. And so, you know, one interest of this that many people have is actually using this for creating microbes that are very good at producing biofuels. So you would take, say, a yeast cell that normally produces ethanol, alcohol, and you would put into it a gene to allow it to produce a biodiesel. The problem is that because this is not a native gene for this organism, it's very inefficient at doing this. So you could imagine using this this artificial selection to actually make yeast that are capable of producing biodiesel as well as they could produce ethanol. I mean, essentially what my goal would be is to figure out a way when you have a very specific goal in mind. I want to create some new drug or some new compound. Figure out how to use biology and how to tweak biology to do that for you.